my field of interest is this, what we call in Germany, Investoren Architektur, which is actually a term used by the architectural critique and architects here in Germany. And it's a vilification of buildings that are produced by the real estate sector, buildings that are in our everyday surroundings. I think that the vast majority of our everyday built environment is actually produced by this sector. And of course, these are buildings and they do this because they want to make a profit with it. So the Investoren Architektur, often polemically vilified by architects, architecture critique, and also by the German public, but actually a very everyday phenomena, and it's also not new. Ever since the rise of market economies, we see commercial investors active on the market. What especially interests me is the motivation of real estate investors and actors in participating, so to say, in the architectural debate, or not to participate in the architectural debate, and how they engage basically with all the stakeholders. So for today, I'd like to give an overview to come to sort of statement on the challenges for urban design regarding real estate. I'd like first to understand urban design and urban development system as we see it also at our university, at the Department of Urban Development. And then I'll introduce the real estate system as I've got to know it, but and then go into a short analysis and discussion and end with some opinionated recommendations. And I hope that this will then be additional base, discussion base for the further sessions which are going. So within the Department of Urban Development, where I'm a university, we understand the urban development or urban design system basically as a set of five circles of objective, Zielkreise, you would say in German, which represent and of course with these disciplines there's a stakeholder involved. And we see these five disciplines as key for any urban development project. They are, of course, design, containing the stakeholders, architects, urban designers, engineers, ecology, representing the environment, the stakeholders representing them, planning, authorities, politicians, sociology, of course, the citizens, and everybody that benefits of the built environment for a non-economical. Last but not least, and I think very important for this workshop today, of course, the discipline of economy with the stakeholders behind that, the real estate sector, so developers, investors, landowners, but also, of course, industries, employers, employees, and everybody that benefits economically. Now, all these disciplines are, of course, joining in this sort of negotiation by their own motivation, their own objectives to actually engage in this urban projects, and they also apply their own methods. And the objective is of course, to bring the project, the one urban project, the center of all these shared objectives. Now, the challenge in urban design is, of course, well, first of all, the question, is the ideal project indeed in the middle? Let's assume that this is the case. We often see that the projects are actually somewhere out of the center of the shared interests. And it's of course the most powerful stakeholders that are able to manage and move and keep basically projects more centered within their own objectives. Now, these powerful stakeholders, as already said, are of course the landowners, developers and investors, the real estate sector and also I think. So, the question is, of course, for today, so how to motivate the real estate sector into the center of shared objectives. Now, in order to be able to say something sensible about that, I think we need to understand better the real estate system. And the real estate system, or basically real estate, is active on basically two markets. The first one would be the space market, where floor spaces are transacted. There's demand coming from national and local economies, and there's a supply coming from the building industry. And the floor spaces then exchanged at rents. Buildings are provided by the building industry with the developers, of course, buying land at a certain price and at the land market, constructing the buildings on that, and of course wanting to make a profit. These buildings become then our building stock, which are then the real estate assets, which leads us to the second market, and I think the most important market for real estate and most interesting, and I think this is something that is often not realized within the field of urban design, that it's the asset market. Because what buildings actually are, from the viewpoint of real estate, is are producers of cash flow. And in the end, what real estate is about is trading these cash flows, trading with these cash flows on the capital markets. So rents are transformed through the building into cash flows that cannot be capitalized on the capital markets, where real estate is in the form of supply by owners selling, providing in this market, and investors buying, coming from a demand from the capital markets, acting on this asset market. Now, the exchange between these two is the rate, or the expected return that you can the return that you can expect on the cash flow coming out of the property. This is then sort of setting the field for real estate, and basically also setting a lot of motivation to act on it. So just to see this a little bit from a different perspective. So my opinion, what real estate is all about is making cash flows and exchanging them on the asset market at a certain rate, driven by capital market supply and demand. To see this in a little different perspective, and to make it perhaps more clear also for I think designers and other stakeholders who are joining in the urban design collective, you can also see it like this. So there's a developer who buys some land and builds a building on it for, say, 7.5 million for the land, 10 million for the building. He hopes that he can generate by renting out the floor spaces and 1 million of annual cash flow. And at current capital markets, real estate is, so to say, priced as a 5% return expectation. So that means that he actually is able to find an investor who is going to buy this cash flow at a 5% return, meaning that for the investment that he pays, he expects 5%, which is 1 million. So the price would be 20 million. Now, of course, the developer can now make a nice profit. And then the building goes into the building stock. The investor keeps it for a while and then decides after, say, 5 years what to do with it. Perhaps he wasn't so good in managing his property, so his cash flows went down to 800,000, and the capital markets are assessing it a little bit more risky, perhaps. So you could see that the value is actually dropped to 12.3 million. The investor will not do nothing probably with the building, but keep it, start managing it in a better way in order to create more cash flow from the building, and perhaps capital markets picked up, and we see that the value increased rapidly. There's a huge capital gain. Now, of course, what is interesting in real estate is that this capital market rate you cannot really influence, but what you can influence by active asset management is, of course, the annual cash flow coming out of the building. These cash flows are, of course, depending on the quality of that building and the way users appreciate them. Now, what I think important to realize at this point is that real estate, the building is a resource. It's not an objective. It's a resource to produce cash flows with. And I think this is a fundamental difference if you look at the objective of urban design or urban development as a whole, where we as societies simply need a building to form our activities within that. But for real estate, a building is a resource. It's one optional resource to invest in compared to other investments like stocks, bonds, etc. In the real estate, in the urban development system, I think you have to see it within its school of thought. The motivation is basically an opportunity for a transaction on the space and asset market. And the objective is to create and enhance cash flows. And the school of thought that fits with that is business administration and everything that comes with it. So that means efficiency in creation and management of its resource, transactions, and contractual relations. So the real estate manager or investor or developer will be busy within this circle of objectives, is sort of trying to manage everything efficiently in order to produce those cash flows, produce a building, a product that can and efficiently produce those cash flows. Technically, he applies as a project asset, and I think in this case, also very much stakeholder management and, of course, marketing. Now, what is the question for urban design? I think we all want to avoid that projects end up too much in the center of the real estate objective and actually outside of the center of the objectives of the other disciplines. And we need to motivate, of course, the real estate sector to participate. Because not every real estate company is behaving like this. There are also some very good ones who are showing very interesting initiatives, but then the question is, of course, how to keep them motivated. But as a final slide, it answers to the original research questions for how to keep a real estate motivated. Things that I think that could work, as already said in the introduction, are incentives. With which the developer can enhance the possibility to generate cash flows on the buildings, which are floor area ratios, but also user subsidies, tax advantages. I think another incentive is innovation in design, which involves a better training of architects in the real estate objective. Because I think I give this presentation, this type of presentation, a lot also to architects, and I often recognize that some basic principles of how real estate works is not present, which also means that, and this is something I also experienced in professional experience, it's very difficult to exchange and speak about the objective of actual real estate. And by doing that, I think architects and designers lose a lot of terrain in suggesting innovations that enhance the objective of the real estate. I think you could, active management by authorities, so manage the development process, ensure engagement of all parties in equal manner, and don't leave, because what the real estate sector tends to do is to step into this management process just by applying business administration strategies to sort of manage these processes and quickly come through. At least in Germany, you see this happening. Education, I think, is an optional answer. Learn how to adopt the language of real estate and also motivation. Understand it, why this sector is joining in the urban design, why it's also necessary. Things which I think are not working or are not sustainable, so to say, would be things like corporate social responsibility. It's very nice that some companies develop this more and more. It gives them some benefits, I think, also in the selection to engage in opportunities. But in the end, it will not be sustainable as it doesn't sustainably generate revenues. Industry standards. I think industry standards are both in investment management are basically marketing tools to gain investors who are basically investing in bringing the capital to invest in real estate. See that a lot of investors behind real estate are churches, for instance, or some other organization, pension funds, and they, of course, find it more interest for reasons which come by the nature, for their own reasons to invest in green buildings, because their end investors are asking for that, but it's not really helping in sustainably fixing these standards into the practice of development. And last but not least, regulation through quality standards set by authorities. I think this is, of course, a method and applied here and there. But I think what you lose is the power of innovation, creativity, and I think also that these things are politically. Thank you.